Friends, any identification is false. It is narcissism versus the bliss of impersonality. The notion that I am is a false assumption based on a long-standing self-deception. The notion of a mind is a false assumption based on a deep, deep craving and clinging. The notion of this is myself is a false assumption based on wrong view. The mentally constructed idea of an internally existing, invisible, not to be found, yet stable, same, an independent entity of identity, being in full control and mastering the individual, is rooted in an inflated false experience of self-importance. This fabricated ego, assuming an imaginary self, rapidly, almost instantly, becomes deeply and tragically in love with itself. This auto-romance, even though merely a hypothetical ideation, nevertheless demands to be gratified, praised, and respected without end, and therefore reacts violently towards any external or internal threats against its postulated unique yet fictional magnificence. The root of all egoism therefore starts right there, when this conceptual notion of an I, me, mine, myself, my identity, my personality is conjured up, is constructed, is fantasized. The effects of this egoism are well known as being wholly catastrophic, both individually, socially, locally, and globally, here and now, later, and in much later lives. The assumed existence of an ego is thus the biggest invisible obstruction and the worst covered calamity for any being in any world, whether divine or human, whether high or low, whether past, present, or into any far future. Basically, this me belief is based on an assumption that either is the body, the feelings, the perceptions, the mental constructions, or the consciousness itself, an embodiment of an otherwise invisible and unobservable self. This representational ego entity is then exalted to the center of the universe. However, this self-imaging is merely a manifestation of simple identification with and clinging to body form, social position, professional occupation, and the so-called personal possessions, which all, of course, are transient, impermanent, not lasting, going away, and therefore ownerless, and therefore not suitable to characterize as possessions. Such is this highly treacherous, dangerous, comic, and tragic ego projection. It is comic and also tragic because this gratifying of an ego self, me, that simply does not exist, is kind of funny. How can you gratify or be proud of or even arrogant out from something that does not exist? That's a fiction. The primary self-deception is this, I am. Then comes the fermentation. I am this and all that. I'm a male, I'm a female, I'm a human, I'm a rich person, I'm a poor person, I'm a beautiful person, I'm good, I'm bad, I'm evil, I'm this, I'm that. Finally is added, I'm better, or I'm worse, or I'm equal to this and that. Yet this I that is assumed in these statements to be this or that does not exist. and neither does the other eyes, egos, that it compares itself to in the social life. They do neither exist either. So all this comparison, staging, is comic and foolish. The Blessed Buddha once said, from everywhere, above as below, set free and released, beyond the concept of I am this or that, one has then crossed a river never crossed before. Thus liberated, thus released, one does never renew any cyclic process of being again. Udana, Inspiration 7.1. He also said, blissful is solitude for one who is content, learned, and who sees the Dhamma. More blissful is harmlessness towards all beings, without any exception. Even more blissful is freedom from any sensual craving whatsoever. Yet the supreme bliss is this elimination of this abysmal conceit that I am. Udana, Inspiration 2.1. And epitomized in the final statement here of the Buddha, Sabba Dhamma Anatta. All states are without a self. All mental states are without an ego, identity, or personality. All material states are without a core, without a substance, without an independent of mind existence. The ego is alone in an unreal world fractured by these hidden false assumptions. The best way to comprehend no self, anatta, is simply to begin with observing and reflecting repeatedly on impermanence, anicca, and suffering, dukkha. Then eventually one comes to understand whatever is always otherwise and never the same, never identical with itself, cannot ever therefore be an identity, cannot ever be any same self. Whatever is ultimately suffering cannot be under control of a self, since if it were, then this self would, by this control, change it into something pleasant and happy. But no self can do that, since it is not in control. If a self is not even in control of itself, fully autonomic, how can it be a true self? Rather, it's just conditions that place out their cause and effect, impersonal processes, cause and effects, neither more nor less. Any identification is false. If you want to know more on this anti-egoism, then go to whatbuddhasaid.net and search for ego or self or anatta. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 77, recorded September 2017 in mist and drizzle, as you see, so we're indoor today. But nevertheless, there are the usual one simile and three questions, and they circle around the field of merit and transmigration, and thereby the field of karma, which is basically the same. But first, the normal intro. Before the normal intro, I'd like to say that this channel has passed 5,000 subscribers after hard work for a number of years, and I'm very happy that this has done. It is also to be noted that 5,000 subscribers is a very small channel on YouTube. So there's not much interest for the Dhamma at these ages. It is said in the commentaries, actually, that teaching Dhamma today
where the average life length of human beings, which goes from 10 years to 100,000 years, when this is under 100 years, then teaching Dhamma is like trying to draw in water with a stick. So you draw some figure in water with a stick, and you can see it, but only for a very short time. Then it disappears again. So anicca, impermanence, in particular regarding retention of the Dhamma, is very, very prevalent now. Well, so be it. The intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, anava, and perfectly self-enlightened was Sibless Buddha. So the simile is about is from the Anguttara Nikaya, which you see here, the numerical discourses of the Buddha, and it's from it contains a numerical means that is all speeches that the Buddha gave with one item, two item, up to 11 items. So there's a book of ones, book of twos, book of threes, book of fours, and this is from the book of eighth. It goes up to book of elevens. This is from the book of eights, and it's a number 34, and it's called the field. And the translation I adapted here is from Sutta Central, a very nice and very, very evasive with multiple translation languages of the text of the Buddha, suttacentral.net, and I'll give the link below to the source text. So it goes like this. Bhikkhu, a seed sown in a field that possesses eight factors does not bring forth abundant fruit. Its fruit is neither delectable, nor does it yield a great profit. What eight factors? Here, the field has mounds and ditches. It contains stones and gravel. It is salty. It is not deeply furrowed. It does not have inlets for water to enter. It does not have outlets for excess water to flow out. It does not have irrigation channels. It does not have boundaries. A rice seed sown in such a rice field that possesses these eight factors does not bring forth abundant fruit. Fruits and seed are not delectable, and it does not yield a great profit. So too, Buddhas, a gift given to ascetics and the recluses who possesses eight factors is not of great fruit and benefit. It is not very brilliant, nor is it pervasive. What eight factors? Here the ascetics and recluses are of wrong view, wrong motivation, wrong speech, wrong action, wrong livelihood, wrong effort, wrong awareness, and wrong concentration. A gift given to ascetics and recluses who possesses these eight factors is not of great fruit and benefit, and is not very brilliant, nor is it very pervasive. Bhikkhus, a seed sown in a field that possesses eight factors brings forth abundant fruit. Its fruit, its result, its effects are delectable, and it yields a great profit. What eight factors? Here the field does not have moons and ditches. It does not contain stones and gravel. It is not salty. It is not deeply furrowed. It has inlets for water to enter, and it has outlets of excess water to flow out. It has irrigation channels, and it has boundaries. A seed sown in a field that possesses seed eight factors bring forth abundant fruit. Its fruits are delectable, and it yields a profit. So too, bhikkhus, a gift given to ascetics and recluses who possesses eight factors is of great fruit and benefit, and it is extraordinarily brilliant and pervasive. What eight factors? Here the ascetics and recluses are of right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration. A gift given to ascetics and recluses who possess these eight factors is of great fruit and is very delectable, and it is extraordinarily brilliant and pervasive. When the field is excellent and the seed sown is excellent and there is an excellent supply of rain, the yield of grain is excellent. Its health is excellent. Its growth too is excellent. Its maturation is excellent. Its fruit is truly excellent. So too, when one gives excellent food to those accomplished in virtuous behavior, it arises of several kinds of excellence. For what one has done is excellent. Therefore, if one desires excellence, let a person here be accomplished. One should resort to those accomplished in wisdom, in understanding. Thus, in this way, will one's own accomplishment flourish and grow. One accomplished in true knowledge and conduct, having gained accomplishment of mind, performs behavior that is accomplished, and accomplishment is for the good. Having known the world as it is, one should attain accomplishment in view, right view, samaditti. One accomplished in mind, a meditator, advances by relying on accomplishments on the path, the Noble Eightfold Way. Having rubbed off all stains, having attained Nibbana, one is then freed from all suffering. This, only this, is a total accomplishment. So did he say in the Book of Eights. So he also said another place that the karmic effect of a gift depends upon the giver, whether the giver is pure, the gift is pure, and whether the receiver is pure and the act of giving is pure. The non-ideal case is, if we take one extreme, a thief which has stolen something. The gift is stolen. He doesn't give it himself. He tells another one to go and give it to someone who is impure, a false soda monk. Worst case scenario, still there is fruit because something is given. Best case scenario is a person who is pure regarding the five precepts, who has made up a gift him or herself with her own hands, with great effort, skill, and carefulness, and then with her own hands or his own hands gives this gift to a recluse or monk who are pure regarding the Vinaya monastic code. Then it is of great fruit, of pervasive brilliance. So when the Buddha uses words pervasive and brilliance, one can see that it's a field of radiation. And this field of radiation is a radiation of probability. It's a very phenomenon of probability that is everywhere present and that will meet the giver wherever they go, because this probability is already there when they come there, whether in this life or in the next life. To the questions. Question 299. It's said about the Buddha, he's gone over, utterly gone, never to returning. Where is the Buddha returning from? The Buddha's, nor is any other enlightened persons ever returning. That's the whole point of the Noble Eightfold Way, is not to return to this or any other world that is impermanent and therefore, ultimately speaking, suffering. So they do not return from anywhere or at any time point. They cannot, their state, this goes both Buddhas and all enlightened beings after death, the Buddha said that they cannot be described, they cannot be designated, they cannot be measured, they cannot even be imagined what state they are in. They are ineffable, inexpressible. They have left no trace of probability when they went into Nibbana, the act of Parinibbana, going into Nibbana, final Nibbana, Nibbana and Upadisesa, Nibbana without trace of clinging left. Question B, where does Nibbana lead or take one? Yeah, it's a non-local and non-temporal state outside of space-time. It has no spatial characteristics, it's not in any place, nor does it take place in any time. So it's a non-temporal, non-local state characterized by lasting happiness, sublime bliss, absolute peace, and complete freedom. Freedom from what? Freedom from all kinds of suffering whatsoever. So, where does Nibbana take one? One can see that it's in this one, there's a person that is expected to go somewhere. But there was no person there in the first place. There was this only this ever-changing states of form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness, the five khandhas. So if there's no person here now, how could there be any person or individuality or ego or self or me or soul on the other side of this Parinibbana event? It's not possible, huh? When one say, where does Nibbana takes one, then it should be understood, this one should be understood in conventional sense, not in the absolute sense, because there is no one person in the first place, before entering Nibbana, neither is after entering Nibbana. While the individuality, which is a stream of consciousness and form, feeling, perception and mental construction, can be characterized on this side of the threshold between samsara and nibbana, then after this threshold, this stream of form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness on the other side cannot be characterized, cannot be described, cannot be expressed in any way. Although one is always toying with the idea, but it basically comes from the fact that all language that we use now as a medium of communication, of transmittance of specific information, this is designed, created to express something that is within samsara. And therefore it is unsuitable and cannot cope with something that is outside nibbana, because it has never experienced that. There's never anyone who has gone to Nibbana who has come back and told about it and how it is. Never so. So therefore, there's no language developed that specifically expresses that. And the language we have here in samsara is basically social conventions about our beliefs and has not much to do with absolute truth. Though, and the Buddha pointed out that this was the highest miracle, it is actually possible to express absolute truth, even in conventional, classical language, based on assumptions tainted with ignorance, greed, and hate. It is possible. We are doing that right now. So this is a miracle that this instruction is possible, that one can point to something outside space-time, something that the language was not developed to express, still one can use is conventional, assuming language, which assume a self, assume a personality, assume an entity, assume a reality independent of mind. One can use that very language to express that which is not an idea, not a mental construction, not an assumption. One can use that language to express or explain the absolute, except Nirvana, which is inexpressible, ineffable, not under the characteristics of conventional language. Question 230. A. Is it true that we all reincarnate until we escape this cyclic existence? Yes, that is true. Not only we understood as human beings, all beings, all conscious beings, and also those who are unconscious, the aviha beings that are unconscious on a high Brahma level, until they die, then they become conscious again on the other side of death. But nevertheless, all conscious beings, from hell beings to the highest devas on level 31, the formless devas, they all pass on until they enter Nibbana, until they experience enlightenment, waking up from the illusion. So that is true. That is true. And we have already, together with all others, undergone an immense billions of universes of rebirths. I told it before, I'll say it again. The Buddha said to his monks, "You see this mountain over there?" "Yes, sir," we say. "Ah, you have made, just in this universe, you have made a mountain of bones bigger than that mountain. What is it that you want? Make a mountain of bones more?" Making mountain of bones, can that be happiness? I think it's difficult to envision, actually. But that's the perspective. So one, instead of being focused on from day to day, or from even from life to life, one scales up one's time frame and then see samsara for what it is, as a cyclic running around birth, aging, sickness and death cycle ever again and again, usually on the low levels, sometimes very, very high up the right levels, but mostly on the intermediate or lower levels, as we are now on level 5 out of 35 or 31 levels, just one level above the animals, which unfortunately clearly is to be seen in human behavior today. B. What is it that is reincarnating? What is it that is transmigrating? Is it a being? No. Is it a me? No. Is it a body? No. Is it a brain? No. Is it a soul? No. Is it an entity? No. So no moments of form, moments of feeling, moments of perception, moments of mental construction, or moments of consciousness lasts more than one single moment. So how can that ever go to some other new life? It doesn't even last in this life, not even for a million millisecond, not even for billions of a second. It lasts 1 or 17 blank moments. 17 if it's a material state, and 1 if it's a mental state. So that's very short, huh? It's actually 100,000 billions, 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 billions of a second. So one is reborn that many times, 10 to the 44 times per second. And it's basically the same that happens during transmigration. What goes from one moment to the next moment actually is causality, is probability, is not entities. It's probability, conditioned specific probability for a new arising of a new mental and material state that has specific properties corresponding to whatever was encoded or programmed in the former moment of form, feeling, and consciousness, are basically of nama rupa, of mind and matter. So this mind and matter moment conditions the next mind and matter moment. And what transmigrate, what's in between there is only probability. So also goes for a particle that is shot through the double slit experiment. We have discussed it before. Between the double slit and the screen where it's recorded, it is only probability. And that goes whether it had mass before it hits the double slits or after when it hits the screen. It doesn't have any mass in between the double slit and the screen. Doesn't have any properties whatsoever, except probability, which is a distribution for certain states to come out, fall out. So same goes with beings. It's a natural phenomena. So one comes with some probabilities, one add to these probabilities during life until the very last moment of death, then these probabilities will carry over to the next life. And consciousness, which has this moment is called Patisanti, the rebirth linking moment, which is a function, kitcha, of consciousness. It is to be able to do this linking, this rebirth linking between this life and the next life, then linking these two together. But it does so also in principle with all the other moments. But these two are called Patisanti, the rebirth linking moment. Basically, this conditioning or causality or probability, this impersonal states of specific probabilities. For example, if one has been a killer, then one will go to a low state. If one has been a giver, then one will go to a high state. But there's many different high states, many different low states. And this is the specific probabilities for that is what is passed on between this moment and that moment, between this life and that life, doing the rebirth linking, the Patisanti moment. If ignorance is dominant in the rebirthing linking moment of consciousness, then animal rebirth is to be expected. It's just some very gross rules here, just to get a handle on it. If the giver, the good Buddhist, the meditator, comes to harmonious peace and is settled in mental calmness based on a long life of doing good, maybe even being able to reach jhana at the moment of death, then a divine rebirth is to be expected. If reaching jhana, then from Brahma level, from level 13 and upwards. If not reaching jhana, but still being in, having no fear, being very peaceful in harmony, leading up to death as a good doer habit, very rare to see, I can report as a doctor. Nevertheless, then a divine rebirth between level 6 and level 12 is to be expected. If anger, hostility, enmity, envy, and hate are dominant in the rebirth linking moment of consciousness, then a rebirth in hell or among the hungry or among the angry demons, the asuras, is to be expected. If jealousy and money thinking, may I keep my values and so on, I don't want to give anything away, is dominant at the rebirth linking moment, the Patisanti moment, just before death, the penultimate moment before death. Then a hungry ghost rebirth is to be expected. So the conditioning of the moment just before death is what determines the rebirth destination, whether high or low. So you can say, but what then the conditioning of this moment, the Patisanti moment, the Chudi moment, just before death, what is conditioning that? That is all past behavior upstream in this life and in former life. They are conditioning this moment, because one moment conditions the next, which conditions the next, is like pearls on a string. So it's very difficult for a killer, a murderer, to come to a rebirth moment that is peaceful, huh? Because the panic has gone. And same thing for a thief, or for one who has performed sexual abuse lifelong, or who has lived in deception and lies. Then this very difficult to attain peace and harmony and joy at the moment of death. Because there's this, all these conflicts that is knocking the door from behind. Same thing with a person who dies with a lot of valuables, not having given anything away, not having been generous, having kept everything for him or herself, even though they shouldn't use it. They have a humongous bank account or all kinds of valuables. They don't even want to give it away to their own family. And of course, much less to somebody else, even to organizations like Doctors Without Borders or something like that. They don't want to give anything away because it's theirs. But right on the other side of death, they found out that it was not theirs anyway. They lost it all. And the best thing you can do, the ideal case is to give all one's valuables away before the moment of death. Because if it is inherited, distributed by the state or by lawyers, then it's not given. It's only the one has relinquished it, given it away before death, not after death. Then it's too late, doesn't have any karmic effect. Before death, one has distributed all one's valuables. Then one has converted one's material bank accounts and valuables to zero, but one has then converted them fully to a karmic investment that will bring one to a higher state on the other side. While if one have kept it, kept the bank account and doesn't even want to give it to the family, then one has no investment, then it was a negative karma on the other side of death. This is basically the hungry ghost mechanism that sits in there. So it's just this absence of greed right at the, and thereby clinging also, right at the death moment that is determining. So, what is actually reborn? Causality, probability, conditioning is reborn. Both now, in every moment, and at the moment of death. So, the two main factors for rebirth in general, can say, for rebirth to occur, is craving for conscious sensing and craving for renewed becoming into a new form of being at the moment of death. One wants to exist. One wants to have a new life. One wants to have a new body. One wants to have more sense pleasure, see more, hear more, smell more, taste more, touch more, think more. Basically, sense craving. Yeah? This is a conscious thing. One craves for colors, tastes, sounds, mental states, touches. If this is present at the rebirth thinking moment, together with craving for becoming, for having life, for being in existence, then one will undergo rebirth according to one's other probabilities accumulated in this life and in all former lives. There's three kind of this rebirth patisanti linking in description in the commentaries. And they go so about what you roots, what kind of roots you have. One is ahitu patisankika. It's a being rebirth without root conditions. They have no good roots. It's a being whose consciousness at the moment of death was not accompanied by any of the three noble root conditions. They neither had any greedlessness, hatelessness, or undeludedness. They didn't have any of the good mulas. So they couldn't understand selflessness, they couldn't understand kindness, and they couldn't understand intelligence and understanding either. It's usually animals. So such beings are usually found in the four lower worlds, apaya, animals, hungry ghosts, angry demons, or hell beings. If such beings, say, are reborn there, again, usually, but if such beings are reborn in at the human states, in the sense sphere, in Karmaloka, then they are crippled, blind, deaf, or mentally deficient. So being born without root conditions, without any of the three good roots, selflessness, greedlessness, and undeludedness, this gives a very bad prognosis. Then the Adwihetu or Duhetu Padisankhika is a reborn with two noble roots, namely greedlessness and hatelessness. They have diminished that during their process of being here in the human state, let's say, in the human state. And they have a good prognosis of reduced their hate also. It is said that there are many beings of those now who has two good roots, namely non-greed and non-hate. Why so? Because there's been four Buddhas already, and they all taught the same as the last Buddha and I teach now, the Dhamma. So because of that, there's many who has these two roots. But can't you have one root? No, you cannot have one root. Because why? Because greed and hate comes up together, and they also goes away together. Because they're basically a mirror image of a state. If the mind wants something, it wants to get it, it's attracted to it, then it's greed. But then it's automatically, it's the same thing, is repulsed, aversive to not having it. This hate. So lobha and dosa, greed and hate, they come up and go together. They are basically two sides of the same coin, whether the mind is attracted to something or whether it's repulsed from something. The awakened mind is neither attracted nor repulsed, nor is it not knowing, deluded about the object. It knows the object in and out, through and through. So, this is second kind. The third kind is Tihetu Patisangika. It's a being born with three noble road conditions. Non-greed, non-hate, and non-ignorance. And they are usually destined to awakening in that very life. Or at least to reach a noble state. That is to be sure about being only seven lives at maximum from Nirvana. So they are very good. I will give a rebirth. I made a drop about rebirth linking specifically. It will come down here, the link, and I'll also give a link below the video about rebirth. All I've written about rebirth and rebirth linking and transmigration on whatbuddhasaid.net. They will come in the video description, and also passing on the screen right here. I can go and study them. They're animal rebirth and hell rebirth and divine rebirth and angry demon rebirth and hungry ghost rebirth. The specific conditions for all these rebirths are explained in details in these Dhamma drops. So I can recommend reading them. They are all in the Dhamma drop number 4. The last question is question 231. It is, what is the meaning of life? Why do we exist? Actually, it is fairly easy to see, but in some ways also very difficult. Lasting happiness is the meaning of life. And all beings search for that in all their doings. It is to, whether they know it or not, whether it's conscious or not, then it's to reach this happiness, this state of happiness. Happiness comes in two flavors. Two kinds. One is lasting happiness, basically a synonym of Nirvana, cannot be found elsewhere. And then there's momentary happiness, which comes and goes, which is not actually happiness. Why is it not? Because if you experience a moment of happiness, whether it's by seeing something, touching something like sex, or eating, tasting something like food, or a mental state by 2000 dollars pour in on your bank account, this arousome mental state of satisfaction. This happiness is momentary. It comes and goes. And if one is appreciating it and welcoming it and liking it when it comes, then per se, by definition, one dislikes it and feels sorrow when it goes down. And it always goes down. This means that happiness is actually only of one kind, lasting happiness. Momentary happiness is also suffering. Why so? Because what you gain on the upstream of it, you have to pay more on the downstream of it. So when it comes, You get some satisfaction, some joy, some pleasure, some happiness. But you have to pay more sorrow because of this tenacious clinging to it, this addiction to it, when it goes away. And also because of this habituation, that if one gets these blips of pleasure, then one gets addicted to it and habituated to it. So this means that one has to have a higher dose of whatever stimuli, a higher amount of money, more beautiful or younger, or more varied sex partner, or sexual stimulation, or same thing with food, which you have to have more and more delicious food to get the same satisfaction. And this means that it's as a whole, this sense pleasure is a ditch or a hole or a pit that you have to fill up, but the more you fill in, the deeper it becomes. And therefore, this investment in sense pleasure is very bad, because you gain something, but you have to pay more. So you gain so much, but you have to pay so much in suffering. So it's a bad investment. So this means if you subtract the happiness, the momentary happiness, from the long-lasting urge, craving, longing, hoping for the same thing, then netto, you lose more than you gain. This means that momentary happiness is also, absolutely speaking, suffering, seen on the long run. A self-accumulating, rolling snowball of suffering is this sense pleasure urge for more and more and more and more. It can never be satiated, can never be saturated, can never be fully satisfied. You have to refeed it and refeed it and refeed it and more and more and more and more forever, and until it becomes untenable. So every being looks for this happiness. You're sitting now here because you look for happiness. I sitting also here because I'm looking for happiness. All the beings out there that is running around in samsara, they also search for happiness, whether eating or working or sleeping or socializing, they are also searching for moments of happiness. So that is definitely the purpose of life, is to reach the state, the mental state of happiness. Since there is only one real mental state of happiness, that is lasting happiness, that is Nirvana, then it goes without saying that the purpose of all conscious life is to reach this state of Nirvana, where you attain a form of happiness that does not disappear because it is outside space-time, because it is outside this, the process of change, of transience. So that's the purpose of life. One way, this has nothing to do with Buddhism, is my private idea, or you can say intellectual piece of toy, is to say, these beings, where do they come from? Maybe consciousness came from Nirvana, and then now it's on its way home. But it can't find its way home. It can find by the noble way, but it tries all kinds of other shortcuts, which all end up to be blind roads. Again and again. It tries to jump the low fence, but then it misses the target. And this process can apparently be very long, many billions of billions of billions of billions of universal cycles, each lasting something like 150 billion years, with many, 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 many lives in each universal cycle. So it's a very, 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 very humongous labyrinth, this samsara, where we are running around in a seemingly endless labyrinth of blind roads. But it is, one can come out. We are coming out right now, little by little. So much for today. Happy Sunday to you. Thanks for your keen attention, clever contribution, and kindness. Especially thank you to the food donors who gave food the last time to me and the cat and the old dog, which you see here, which I think won't last long. But nevertheless, so he will go to a new state according to his particular conditioning. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you, and have a nice and noble day.
Friends, releasing the misconception, I am, my ego exists, myself is real, is real freedom. Getting out of the ego prison. Regarding this, the Blessed Buddha once noted, it is by clinging friends that the notion I am occurs, not without clinging. And by clinging to what does the notion I am occur, not without clinging. It is by clinging to form, to feeling, to perception, to mental constructions, and to consciousness that the notion I am occurs. And it's not without this clinging. Suppose, friends, a young woman or a young man, fond of fashion and jewelry, would examine her own face in a mirror. She would look at it with clinging, not without clinging. Even and exactly so too, it is by clinging to form, to feeling, to perception, to mental constructions, and to consciousness that this notion I am occurs. It is not without this subconscious, quite detrimental, deep and rigid clinging. Clinging to what is impermanent, transient, and prone to decay is always very painful. What is changing and painful cannot be mine. It cannot be what I am, nor can it be myself. Understanding this, the intelligent, noble disciple is disgusted with all forms, is disgusted with all feelings, is disgusted with all perceptions, is disgusted with all mental constructions, and even every form of consciousness. Being disgusted induces disillusion. This disillusion launches mind into mental release. When released, then mind becomes unagitated. By being entirely imperturbable, one attains awakening right there and then, and one instantly understands this mind is irreversibly freed. Rebirth is ended. The noble life is concluded. Done is what should be done. There's no state of being after or beyond this. So did you say? In comments, one can say that if we take a closer look at this as a seemingly self-evident statement, I am, then there are two components, an I and an am. And which one is wrong here? The am part designating existence, this cannot be denied. This existence is, however, neither static nor being of an entity, nor presence of an I. What is it then that aim, that is, that exists? It is just these five dynamic and ever-changing processes, which are not entities, processes of form, feeling, perception, construction, and mental consciousness, that all arise and cease according to their conditioned causes. What is it then that have form? a body to be seen in the mirror? No, it is the process of form itself that has this frame of appearance. What is it then that feels pleasure, pain, and neutral feeling? It is the process of feeling itself that feels pleasure, pain, and neither pleasure nor pain. What is it then that perceives, that experiences, if it's not a me? It's the process of perception itself that perceives various objects. What is it then that constructs, intends, plans, and hope, if it's not an I? It is the process, impersonal process of mental construction itself that create these tendencies. What is it then that is conscious, if it's not a myself, if it's not my ego or it's not my soul? It is the process of consciousness itself that arises and ceases right there, ever again. Nothing else than these ownerless conditions, these selfless states, these causeless phenomena without independent substance is ever there. So in conclusion regarding the statement, I am, the I am part is okay. Since the five clusters of clinging actually are momentarily in existence. However, the I part is wrong. Since there's no ego in there, this hypothetical self entity is an illusion. An illusion in conclusion. Don't feel any existentialistic musea here. Just let this ego evaporate as it may. It was never really there in the first place. So nothing is lost. Because you cannot lose what you never had. And a fundamental freedom is gained thereby. This selflessness is sublime. As the blessed Buddha once noticed, blissful is solitude for one who is content and who sees the true Dhamma. More blissful is harmlessness towards all being without any exception. Even more blissful is freedom from any sensual urge or craving whatsoever. Yet the supreme bliss is this elimination of that abysmal conceit, I am. Udana, Inspiration 2.1. Clinging to the conceit that I am. The source for this is the group sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 22, Sutta number 83. And on clinging to personality view, Sakaya Ditti and selflessness, Anatta, just go to what Buddha said and search for Anatta. Search for no self. This concludes clinging to the concept, the illusion, the fantasy that I am. Thank you.